In the science of screenwriting, what's your favorite chapter, or maybe a chapter that was most challenging that you felt very proud of?
I think my favorite chapter is chapter one, because we got to give kind of the overview of the dance we were going to try to do for the potential screenwriter, or anyone really who's interested in why movies are so fascinating, why human beings will go into a dark place with dozens of total strangers and sit quietly for hours. And that behavior alone is, you know, worth a good thorough psychological investigation. So in chapter one, I think we had a lot of fun building up what we were going to do in the rest of the book. But I like the chapter that's on the creative stages of the screenwriter. That's a chapter that involved quite a bit of research in studying how the creative process itself plays out in any artist, in any creative act, but in screenwriting, the importance of the story itself. So you had asked Paul a question about yes or no, if you focus on the audience, would that make your screenplay a success? My answer would be a flat out no. You must have the story. The story is what will make your screenplay a success. The ability to pace your story, to weave your story, to tell your story in a way that's respectful, even playful, with the human brain that's going to be processing it, that will give your story the attraction and the further success. But without the story, you can play people all you want. It's, you know, if you don't have something to tell them, there's no reason to engage. And in the chapter on the creative processes, the stages of creativity, I got to do quite a bit of research on what we know about creativity. Creativity is considered the ultimate cognitive process. So we do all these things in our brains, right? We pay attention. We perceive all of our different sensory activities happen in the brain. So you don't see with your eyes. You see with your occipital lobe. You don't hear with your ears. You hear with your auditory cortex. So all of these amazing things happen in the brain, but they happen in parallel, processing simultaneously. So you're hearing and seeing while you're thinking about what you're hearing and seeing, while you're remembering what you've seen and heard, while you're predicting what may come. So our brains are these beautiful orchestrations of simultaneous processes, and creativity emerges from that unique, totally individual, no two brains do anything exactly alike. So I think that's my favorite chapter. It was a lot of fun to explore what helps creativity, what hinders creativity, and what the screenwriter can use to get over slumps, you know, use to break through blocks. So that was my favorite, I think.
Thinking of your favorite films, are you able to look at it from another perspective and see the science behind why you like certain films?
Sometimes, rarely. I'm a devotee of stories. I love going to movies, and I don't pretend to be a scientist. I'm just a movie watcher in there. I can train myself, you know, to take, like Paul does, take clips, sequences, and then I can take apart pieces of movie. But if I'm given an opportunity to be told the story, I take it. Storytelling is, it's the human gift. There are, as far as we know, no other vertebrate animals that engage in fantasy, that engage in storytelling. It makes us uniquely human. And from my perspective, it's this connection to language, which, as I was saying, is begun before birth. We listen in utero for that voice that is closest to us. So the person carrying us is the most important voice that we hear. And I think that, I don't know, it's magic to me. And I'm a scientist, I'm all about data, but it is magic to me that we communicate at all, that we get each other even, you know, vaguely, and that we do it so effortlessly and so successfully. The gift of language, the gift of storytelling, is what I've taught for decades, and it's still just a magical mystery tour. It's amazing how we don't run out of language. We don't run out of stories. Yeah, you get boy meets girl, or, you know, these kinds of repetitive plots, but each and every movie about boy meets girl captures us as an audience, holds us. We are as if we'd never seen the whole scenario before. That's a good movie, right? The ones that don't make it are the ones that have not added enough of that individual creativity to the storytelling.
So even language, if it's not our native language, we can still relate. You know how people love seeing foreign films? Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Is there something different about that? Or
that's a great question, and I love talking about when, so as if you were deaf, as if you did not have auditory processing, and so you were following along closed caption, you're reading the subtitles, you still get all the emotion that's portrayed visually. But there's a lot of data that suggests the sound, not just the language, but including the language, but the background music, the tension sounds, the relaxing sounds, the auditory cues that a screenwriter adds to their film to create that emotional mood. When those are missing, the movie is much more intellectual process and much less of a, you know, full body emotional, I'm in this story. So watching foreign films takes a different mindset. When you go to watch a foreign film, you know you're going to be watching the subtitles to get the dialogue. If you're a hearing person and you can still have the background cues to what's going on, it's much more successful. For people who have auditory disabilities, movie watching is an entirely different experience.